Lee Strobel, how you doing today?
I'm doing great. I'm here in Houston, and things are cooling down from the hot summer, so that's always a good thing.
Yeah, yeah. Although your cold is usually nowhere near as bad as my New York cold. So
that's true. That is very true.
Like, your cold is kind of like the place I want to escape to in the winter, right? so it's great. But I'm a little jealous. But you also, as always, are very busy. You've got a new book out, The Case for Heaven: A Journalist Investigates Evidence for Life After Death. Now, as people know, you've done, obviously, The Case for Christ, which was huge, The Case for Faith, The Case for the Creator. You've done a million books at this point, yeah. I feel like. And every
feels
subject,
like it.
It feels like, yeah, anybody who's written a book knows what that process is like. But, you know, every topic is so captivating and essential to the human experience, right? I mean, that, I think you always find the thing that people have the questions about. And the afterlife is really a huge subject that you had touched on in other ways, but not to this degree. Why did you choose to make this the focus of your latest book?
Well, it started several years ago when I almost died. My wife found me unconscious on the bedroom floor. She called an ambulance. I woke up in the emergency room, and the doctor looked down at me and said, "You're one step away from a coma, two steps away from dying." And then I went unconscious again and lingered between life and death for a while until the doctors were able to save me. I had kind of an unusual medical condition called hyponatremia, which is a severe drop in blood sodium level. I lost a kidney as part of it. Ultimately, the doctors were able to raise the blood sodium level without causing brain damage or physical damage, which often happens. And I recovered. But, you know, when you're in that position of kind of hovering over that blurry line between life and death, it's a very clarifying experience, if nothing else, because at that moment, nothing is more important than what happens after you close your eyes for the last time in this world. I mean, are we cast into oblivion? Do we go through a cycle of births and rebirths and rebirths? Is there a heaven? Is there a hell? How do we know? And so that's what kind of was the seed that eventually bloomed into my new book, The Case for Heaven.
Well, and it's one thing to be somebody who is preaching on those things. We believe those things as believers. It's another thing when you go through a near-death experience like that, right? Where you are really faced with, okay, now all the things I know are true, I know in my heart are true, the reality of that this could actually happen in a few moments when you were in that, you know, position, I would imagine it changed and clarified some things for you once you recovered.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, I was a Christian at the time this happened. I was a pastor. And so I believe what the Bible teaches about the afterlife. But when, you know, I've also got a skeptical gear. You know, my background's in journalism and law. And so when you're in that position, you begin to say, okay, I believe what the Bible teaches, but what does science say about it? Does science corroborate that and support that? Or what about philosophy and so forth? So it just caused me to dig a little deeper. And I was really kind of surprised by several things I discovered, because they really do, I think, in an unexpected way, corroborate what the Bible tells us about the afterlife.
Well, that's the thing, right? You'll talk to a lot of atheists or agnostics, and especially with atheists, they'll say there's no evidence. You have no evidence of anything, right? And I've been marinating and thinking a lot about Romans 1:20, and I think it's I think it's one of the most fascinating scriptures, because it basically tells us you have no excuse. Look out your window, right? I mean, that's sort of like the Billy translation of it. But you know, you have that reality of the complexity of everything around us, and so we can talk about that for God's existence. And I think it's a great proof of that. Yeah. When it comes to the afterlife, people are going to say, but you have no proof of that, right? Nobody's come back, which is not entirely true. I mean, Jesus, came back, but nobody has come back and told us, you know, anything about it. So when you say you encountered those things, obviously we want people to grab the book, read it, but what was the most compelling evidence that you felt you were encountering as you went on this journey?
Well, clearly it was the evidence of near-death experiences. In other words, people who are clinically dead, and yet their consciousness, their mind, their spirit – their soul continues to exist and see things and experience things that are impossible if indeed they weren't having an authentic out-of-body experience. So in other words, you know, the Apostle Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So, and Jesus told the repentant criminal on the cross, today you'll be with me in paradise. So the suggestion is there's really two aspects to heaven. The first one is called the present heaven or the intermediate state. So it teaches that when we die, our soul, our spirit separates from our physical body and continues in a conscious state, either with Jesus in paradise or separated from him in Hades. And then the second process, the second stage begins at the consummation of history when Jesus returns. We're united with our resurrected bodies. We go through final judgment, and then we spend eternity in a very physical place, whether heaven or hell. And so the question is, well, how do we know that our spirit, our soul, our consciousness does survive our death? I was a skeptic about near-death experiences until I found out we have 900 scholarly articles that have been written and published in scientific and medical journals over the last 40 years. This is a very well-researched area. In fact, The Lancet, which is the famous medical journal in the United Kingdom, concluded in an article that all of the alternative explanations, oh, this is oxygen deprivation, this is just hallucinations, none of those can account for the features of near-death experiences. They just don't account for it. And so I began as a skeptic, but I thought, you know what? You hear people say, oh, I died and I went to heaven. I met Jesus. He's 5'10". He's got brown eyes. I don't know. I can't corroborate that. So I said, what can I corroborate? And I, in my book, talk about numerous instances where we have corroboration. I'll give you an example. There was a woman named Maria who died of a heart attack in the hospital. And she's clinically dead. And yet, she describes later, I was conscious the whole time. My spirit separated from my body. I watched from the ceiling of the hospital the resuscitation efforts on my physical body. And then my spirit floated up through the floors of the hospital and out of the hospital. And then she said, when my spirit returned to my body and I was revived, she said, by the way, there's a tennis shoe on the roof of the hospital, a third story ledge, and it's a man's tennis shoe. It's dark blue. It's left footed. There's some wear over the little toe and the shoelace is tucked under the heel.
Wow.
And so they went up and they found it exactly as she had said. How do you account for that if indeed she didn't have an authentic separation of her spirit, her soul, from her physical body? In fact, the most fascinating study was 21 blind people, a lot of them blind since birth. Some of them, like Vicky Umapeg, who was 26 years old, killed in a car accident, she had never even seen a shadow her whole life. She was blind since birth. And yet, during this near-death experience, she watched the resuscitation effort. She saw people for the first time. She saw plants and animals for the first time. She actually met deceased relatives and was in the very light of the presence of God. And then when her spirit returned to her body, she was blind again. And this is the pattern with blind people, that they're able to see many of them during their near-death experience. And as one medical researcher said, this is medically impossible.
Well, how would they even know how to describe or express what they're seeing if they've never seen it, right? It's one thing for somebody to tell you something, but that I had not heard that one.
Yeah.
That's incredible to me. And I know this is not a few years ago, it was longer. I think it was the 80s, but there was one survey question. And as a journalist, this always bothers me, you know, when you have Pew or someone go out and ask a question and it's so compelling and then they never ask it again, right?
Yeah,
and
right.
they had asked this question about these experiences, and I don't have the exact number. It was somewhere between, and maybe you can correct me if you've encountered it, but 20 and 25% of the American public had said that they had either gone through an experience like this or knew somebody who had. That's compelling when you have one in four people or one in five people saying that this is an experience that they've come into close contact with in some way. So
yeah.
It seems like these experiences, and I know some of the critics have said, oh, you know, every experience is so different, but what I've noticed, and I'm sure you could speak to this, the similarities are far more glaring in these experiences.
That's exactly right. And here's, based on that, and you're right, there is a common core to what generally happens, even though they vary to some degree. But I interviewed for my book John Burke, who's a Christian pastor, a great church in Austin, Texas. He's actually been a friend of mine for about 30 years. He spent about 35 years studying 1,000 near-death experiences. And his conclusion is, and this is powerful, his conclusion is if you look at what actually takes place in the core of these near-death experiences, and not how you interpret them, because you can look at them, the experience, through your worldview and interpret them differently. Look at what actually takes place. He said they are consistent with Christian theology. They're consistent with the teachings of the Bible. And he backs that up verse by verse. He actually wrote a book called Imagine Heaven that dealt with this. So I interviewed him for my book, and I think that's highly important. Now, it's important to understand that these people who have near-death experiences are not irrevocably dead. They're going to come back. They're clinically dead. No heartbeat, no measurable brain waves, no breathing. Some are in the morgue. Some are being, like one woman was being transported to the morgue when she regained consciousness and said, by the way, I can tell you the designs on the ties and the jokes that were being told during my resuscitation efforts when I was clinically dead. These people are clinically dead, but they're not irrevocably dead. So the Bible says in Hebrews, we're appointed once to die and then the judgment, although it doesn't mean immediately the judgment. We're once appointed once to die. These people are not dead in that sense. They're not irrevocably dead. They're getting a taste of perhaps what occurs in an afterlife. But the key thing is that it's corroborative of the biblical teaching that our soul, our spirit, our consciousness does continue after our demise.
Yeah, and I know the critics will try to say it's all about your brain waves and your brain is not quite, you know, it lags behind. But as you were saying, we have studies showing and we have experts saying that that does not explain why this happens the way that it does. And one of the things that I just want to emphasize that I find compelling in these stories is the overwhelming emotion. Obviously, when we go through something, a near-death experience, we want to come back. You know, we don't want to die. But there's so many people who experience the afterlife in those moments who will report being told that they need to go back and that they don't want to. They have this overwhelming peace. And that I always found that incredibly fascinating.
Well, and, you know, on the flip side of that, about 24% of cases are not pleasant. They are horrific, some of them, or unpleasant. For instance, Howard Storm was an atheist, professor of art at a secular university and chairman of the art department. He died in the hospital, and yet he said his spirit body continued to exist. He saw his dead body on the table, and there's some guys in the corridors who said, hey, come with us, come with us. Really nice guys. So he followed them down the corridor, down another corridor, down another corridor. And then they started to get abusive. They started to get profane. And then they attacked him. And he said, I was reduced to roadkill. His ear was torn off. His eye was gouged out. He said, there's no horror film that can capture the cruelty that they did to me. And in the midst of this, he called out to Jesus. Jesus came and rescued him. How real was this? Well, when he recovered and his spirit returned to his body and he was revived, he not only renounced his atheism, he not only resigned his tenured position at the university, he became an ordained pastor and today is a pastor of a small church in the United States. So, you know, these are real experiences. I had, when I had hyponatremia, I had hallucinations. That's a common phenomenon when you have hyponatremia, when you have low blood sodium level. That's what happens. You see things that aren't there. So I know what it's like to have a hallucination. These are not hallucinations. Hallucinations tend to be scattered. They tend to be nonsensical. Right. They tend to be shallow. These are deep and these change lives. And as I say, go to the Lancet, you know, the most prestigious medical journal in Britain, and it documents that none of these alternative explanations that critics raise can account for all the phenomenon of near-death experiences.
Yeah, no, it's incredible. And I want to backtrack a little bit on something that is an interesting debate and discussion that centers on this. And you had mentioned Jesus on the cross, you know, telling the criminal, you'll be with me today. There's this discussion about death that some will believe, okay, well, you die and your spirit, you basically go to sleep until the judgment, right? There's that perspective, which I find a hard time. I find that difficult to sort of mix up with what we just talked about, right?
Yeah.
Which I will see, you'll be with me today. So can you talk about that just a little bit and sort of the theology behind that and where you stand?
Yeah, I think it's a, you know, it's an idea of what's called soul sleep. It you know, sleep is used sometimes as an euphemism for death in the Bible. You know, for instance, we see in 1 Corinthians 15 that, you know, when this ancient creed of the church and Paul's giving this to the Corinthians and says, by the way, there's 500 eyewitnesses to the resurrected Jesus, many of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. So it's a euphemism often for death. But, you know, I go back to what Jesus told the parable. It's the only parable, I believe, where names were used, where we have the rich man and Lazarus who have died, and Lazarus. And so there's a consciousness. Now, you can say, well, that parable was not intended to teach about the afterlife. And I agree with that. It's making another teaching. But I don't believe Jesus would mislead us by teaching a parable that misconstrues what happens after we die. So the rich man and Lazarus are conscious. They are physically aware and present. And so I think that mitigates also against this idea that we're just asleep until the judgment.
So you wrote this book, and we could go on for 3 hours about this because I'm so fascinated. And as you know, these are topics over the years you and I have talked that I'm deeply fascinated by. What are you hoping at the end of, you know, reading The Case for Heaven? What are you hoping the audience, the reader, is feeling and experiencing?
I hope they're experiencing hope, encouragement, that this is not our permanent home, that there is a, as Jesus uses a metaphor in John chapter 14, of a heaven's a home. You know, you think of what does home represent? Warmth, security, love, and so forth. And that is what heaven is going to be. And, you know, the other thing, I think it changes the way we look at our circumstances today. I'll give you an example. Right now in my life, I am super busy. I'm stressed out. I've got a lot of things going on, and it's a difficult time in my life. But you know what? I have a vacation on my calendar. I know it's coming. And so I'm able to cope with the difficulties and the stresses of my current situation because I say, you know what? I got a vacation coming up in just a short time. Well, when we may not have our death on our calendar and know when we're going to die, but if you're a follower of Jesus, you know you have that coming in your future. And it helps you deal with, I think, our current circumstances to know that ultimately it's going to be okay. You know, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has even conceived of what God has in store for those who love him. In other words, a place of incredible adventure and joy and satisfaction and fulfillment and no pain, no sorrow, no regret. And so to know that that's kind of on the calendar, so to speak, I think helps us deal with, and you hear this in countries where there's persecution of the church, that heaven gives them a sense of courage for dealing with the present situation.
Well, listen, I think that's actually an amazing way of explaining your goal with this. And it actually gave me, I was smiling as you were describing it, because it brings that peace and that reminder that when times are difficult, you can look at it that way and really glean that peace and strength that Jesus can give us. So I appreciate you taking the time today to take us through the book. And if you're watching or you're listening to this, make sure you get The Case for Heaven, A Journalist Investigates Evidence for Life After Death. Thanks so much, Lee.
Thanks, Billy. God bless you, man. Great to see you again.